Listener discretion is advised.
Stryker
and Dr. Drew.
LoveLine, coast to coast.
That's what I'm talking about, Anderson. Nasrenna. All right, I'm Stryker in for Adam Carolla. Once again, I apologize already for the next 2 hours because I will be sucking, so to speak, for you. And this is very weird. We're going to talk to James Marsters. That's how you say it, right?
Yeah, Marsters. Thank you.
We're going to wrap
so
with you.
Get it wrong.
Yeah, and I don't get it wrong. You know why?
Why?
Because I'm a handsome gentleman tonight.
That's right. That's right.
We you just hung out in the parking lot a
little
bit.
You had a good look coming in.
Well, thank you.
Did.
And
yeah.
we'll get to know
you were,
each other.
You were 90 seconds early.
90
which
seconds
is
early.
Cool. Yeah.
Normally, I'm 90 seconds.
Yeah,
my
but
girl
okay.
will tell you.
90
yeah.
seconds early is just so cool.
Yeah. yeah. Well, this is going to be
weird. I was
5
minutes early, which is not cool.
No.
90 seconds, that's sweet.
Because we're in L.A.
Yeah, exactly.
See, if we were in a different country, you would take the top bunk and I'd take the bottom bunk. But because we're in America. So Dr. Drew will be on the program, is on the program, but this is crazy because he's not in this room. He's in Sacktown. Drew, can you hear me?
Oh, yeah, I'm right here.
Hello, Drew.
Hey, James.
What are you doing in Sacramento?
I was speaking in Sacramento State. I'm here at the Zone, 100.5 in Sacramento, who, by the way, have... The reason I'm saying their name is they have spoiled it. I want to announce the name of this radio station because they have spoiled it for all other radio stations. They brought me gifts and CDs and food. And
I heard...
They got their act together. It's been fabulous.
I heard Adam one time say, Drew, I heard someone dropped a quarter in Wisconsin. You go in there to speak? And I was like, Adam, what are you doing?
I'm so sorry, Drew. I didn't know you. I was opening you up for this much criticism. I just
listen,
like,
it's
just asking
right.
what you were doing. Sir.
Adam is a dick and
unacceptable.
All people who are paid to be funny have to do this, you know.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Drew, I got an email from some girl in Sacramento today that I think she works at that radio station, Allison or something.
Okay.
Is she there near you?
No.
Look under the table.
Oh, is that what that is?
Yeah, exactly. All right, so Drew, we're going to do this. We're going to hang out with James. We're going to take calls. The phone number is 1-800-LOVE-191. James Marsters is here. You play Spike on Buffy the Vampire Slayer.
I try.
Let me just get on my knees and praise you for 1 minute. I see a lot of actors on TV of our genre, younger guys, and I'm like, how in the world are they on TV? What? You know, I'll see them on talk shows. They have the personality of a table. I saw you on Kilborn in a... Maybe 2 years ago?
He's fun.
Yeah, he's fun.
You know what I suspect about Greg Kilborn?
Gay.
I never really thought about that. I usually have a good gaydar, actually,
okay.
but I didn't go off on him.
Right.
No, I think he does his own intro. Like, and now, Craig Kilborn! And then he goes on stage and does himself.
Exactly.
And
he does himself.
I suspect that. Yeah, I tried to catch him on it, you know, when I was on, but I couldn't.
Well, let me finish my whole thought here, James.
Right,
so I saw you on there.
Gotta calm down.
And you were on fire. And I was like, now this guy's funny. He does every accent in the world. You play a British guy, right?
Yeah.
In the show. And I'm like, man, that guy's got skills. So you have it, man. And that's, congratulations.
Man, it's just practice. There's a British guy that's on the show and he keeps correcting me. And,
really?
Yeah. Because in the first couple episodes, I really sucked.
No, you didn't.
Wah.
Are you moving your lips when other people are talking or is your accent sucked?
Yeah. The first accent, I sounded more southern than anything else.
Can you like talk for the next 20 seconds in the accent? I know you're not acting right now.
Well, you're not really paying me. I mean, I'm in a hall, you know, and, you know, I talk this way and I take my shirt off and everything, you know, for the people who pay me.
Right.
But you're not paying me, so,
no.
You know. I'm not a slut.
That is terrific.
I'm a fool.
Excellent
job. You.
Very good. That is James. If you want to speak to him and ask him questions about Buffy and his character or speak to Drew or myself, call right now. And I guess we're going to go to Jessica. You're 17 on LoveLine. What's up?
Hi.
Hi.
Hey.
For 3 years or so, I've been in a pain. Like, you know how people like rough sex? I like violent sex. Okay, and I'm just wondering, where did it come from?
Where's your dad?
Where's my dad? He lives like a few miles away. He
what
never abused
like?
Me. I've never been abused or anything.
Yeah, but did you see some violent stuff in your house?
No, nothing like that went on. Actually, I was pretty isolated my whole life.
Pretty isolated?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, my mom wouldn't even let me watch scary movies.
What kind of rough sex, Jessica, how rough and like holding down?
Do you mean protected or isolated?
Oh, I guess more protected.
Uh-huh.
I like as far as blood, and I like to be like hit, like actually punched all over my body, like beat up, and bruised.
What else going on in your life?
A lot of pain.
What else goes on in your relationships? Pretty chaotic?
I usually don't have relationships.
How come?
Because, I don't know, I just, you can't really have a relationship with guys who will do that.
Drew, she has sex with a guy, she makes him bleed to death, he gets the hell out of Dodge. That's what I would do.
They
right, Jessica?
They do that to her.
Hmm. Vice versa, I'm sure, right, Jessica?
Huh? I'm sorry?
Do you like to scratch and beat them as well, or just...
No. I'm very submissive.
Wow.
Scratching's good, though.
What about biting, James?
No. Biting hurts.
Well, I'm like actually that. More concerned with the fact that you're unable to have a relationship.
Well, that does kind of suck.
Has there been a lot of drama in your life?
I suppose.
Like what? What's been happening?
I don't know. Stupid stuff. Like, my parents got divorced when I was 12, and moved to, like, 4 different houses and changed schools about 10 different times.
Have you tried to hurt yourself?
No.
You never gotten real depressed or anything?
No, I've been depressed, but I never tried to kill myself or anything.
Have you been hospitalized or on medication?
Yeah, I've been in the mental ward, like, 3 times.
All right. So please don't present this like it's an isolated phenomenon. Like, I'm this normal person, and everything's great in my life, except I like to be punched. This is part of a more global psychiatric problem. And I have noticed that kids that move around a ton, like military kids and stuff, do have a tendency to go towards more violent kinds of sexual behaviors. So that's part of it. But the more serious issue is what's going on with you and your inability to get a sense of yourself, to regulate your feelings, and to have a real relationship. Those are very serious problems.
So are you talking to someone now, Jessica, other than Drew, myself, and James? Do you have professional help?
No, I didn't really think I needed help for it. I was just curious as to where it came from.
Well,
you do, though.
That's the point. That's the point. These things don't happen in a vacuum. This is part of a more global, a much bigger problem. Are you getting help, appropriate mental health care right now?
I go to counseling.
Okay.
Because this is not going to stop, you know. I mean, if you like this kind of guy now, you're going to like this kind of guy for a long time.
I have no problem with liking this. I mean, I enjoy myself. It's safe.
Well, I know, but the ramifications for the rest of your life, you know, like 5 or 10 years down the line, it kind of messed up.
You've been in and out of psychiatric hospitals. Something's not going quite right.
Yeah, but that really didn't have a lot to do with that. I can't see any connection.
Well, I can. Okay.
You know those kind of guys.
I'm telling you, don't focus on the specific behavior here. Understand this is just a tiny little manifestation of a bigger problem.
Okay.
And these kind of guys, I know these kind of guys, they don't change and they suck.
Well, they're abusers. You know
what I mean? If they hit you, they suck. And they'll
do it harder and worse as time goes by.
Yeah, and it just, you know, it is possible to find a good guy who can be that way with you. You know what I mean? And there's a way to do that in a way that is actually kind of, I don't know, maybe I'm a sick guy, but healthy. That's possible. But you shouldn't put up with an asshole. No one should.
If you look at lists of men that tend to be physically abusive to women, their characteristics, one of them is that they hold women down during sex and physically abuse them there.
And they were most likely abused themselves, right, Drew, growing up?
Oftentimes. In some fashion, yeah. Sure.
All right, Dave, Chris.
Yes.
What's up? You're 18 on LoveLine.
I'm gay, and I'm trying to come out to my parents and sisters and friends that I'm gay, and I don't know exactly how to.
Why do you want to come out to your parents? How many 18-year-olds sit down and announce at the dinner table that they're having sex with a heterosexual relationship?
Yeah, but they're always asking me why don't I bring my girlfriend over to meet them.
Do you have a girlfriend, Chris?
No.
Mm-hmm. Do you have a boyfriend?
No, not really. I have this guy I've been seeing, but there's this girl that likes me a whole lot, but like I don't know how to tell her or anything, you know?
Yeah.
Well,
good for you for admitting it to yourself so early. A lot of guys, it takes a long time to actually admit it to themselves.
Well,
so
your parents, are they likely to be accepting of you and your preference?
Not with that accent, Drew. No way.
Well, I'm wondering.
No, not really, because it's like I kind of like came out and told my mom in a way, like hinted around, and she was like really upset and wanted me to leave and everything, you know?
All right, so why do you want to put yourself through that? Do not tell your parents. That's not going to accomplish anything except give you a lot of pain.
Uh-huh.
What you need to do is develop a network of friends who are also gay.
Right.
Who have also dealt with this process of coming out.
Yeah.
And after you develop a strong network and, you know, really thought about this for some time, then you begin to come out a little bit. So you have a foundation to go back to, because many times these things don't go well. And if you are really expecting, you know, delightful experiences with your parents and it goes bad, where do you have to turn?
Hey, Chris. Chris.
Yeah.
Do you have a lot of gay friends that are just your friends? Do you have as Drew said, are there people that you can go to that are also gay where you can talk about it with them before you so-called come out to everyone else?
Well, not really. Most of them are like older than I am.
Are you in high school still?
No, I graduated.
Oh, okay.
Every urban center is gay and lesbian youth centers, and that's a great place to go for exactly this kind of stuff.
And you could probably get a lot of action when you're there. All right, Chris. Find some more gay men. Talk to them. Hold off on telling your folks.
Good for you, man. You got balls. But
understand, it's always suspect when a 17, 18, 19-year-old wants to sit at the dinner table and announce anything to their parents. They have an agenda. They want to get something out of their parents, a rise, an FU or a something to their parents. Because, I mean, James, did you sit down with the first time you had sex and announce it at the dinner table?
Actually, you did, didn't you, James?
Hi, Mommy. I'm gay.
No. I hid it from them. I cleaned up the house really well every Sunday morning after the Saturday party. They never knew anything.
Why is he vacuuming?
Angel. But I was in fact.
You cleaned up all of Modesto after you had sex.
No, we cleaned up the punches of the holes in the walls and all the spilled beer and everything. We had a cadre of people who would do that. But
What is Modesto like? That's near Fresno.
Yeah, we got some peaches and some almonds and it's a good place to grow up. It was a very good place for me to grow up until about age maybe 12. At which point I got interested in drama, at which point there was nothing for me.
After masturbation, the day is shot in Modesto.
Yeah. Basically, adolescent hits, and there's no, if you want a job with a chick's gum.
There you go. Let's go to Anthony.
Yeah?
You're on Loveline. You're 19.
Hi.
Hey. Good. Okay, hold on one sec. Let's go to Cameron. What's up? You're 21 on Loveline.
Hey, how's it going?
Good.
All right. I have a lot of problems.
Yeah, apparently.
I am a drug addict. I've switched from pot, never been a hardcore drug addict, but I've switched from pot to alcohol.
Speed. Alcohol, sure.
I spent 4 years as a camp counselor. Mm. Never indulged in anything, but yet at the same time I have an attraction to small girls.
Young girls or small girls?
Prepubescent.
Okay.
All right. You need, Cameron, were you sexually abused yourself?
As far as I know, no.
Huh. Do you suspect you might have been?
It's possible. My mother was sexually abused. My parents. Right. Both my parents are alcoholics.
All right. Let's assume you were. Be that as it may, why don't you get yourself some help before you harm somebody?
My question was, I'm currently looking, going to get help through the university I'm going
Great.
To. My question was, is there anything else I should possibly do to help cure myself? I have all other problems as well.
Well, the one thing I'm concerned with is you doing something that could harm other people and irreparably change your life.
This
one of the ways to contain those kinds of impulses, those behaviors that are difficult to contain, sexual behaviors, is to go to SA, Sex Addicts Anonymous, and work a program, get a sponsor, and see to it that you don't get into harm's way.
Drew, why do you go to SA? Seminar class, if you like young girls, that means you're addicted to sex?
He's asking what else he can do other than go to a psychiatric center or university hospital.
All right.
That's something you can go do right now.
I'm currently, in the next couple of weeks, I've come to the point that I had been in therapy before. For a year, I got out of it. I was not honest with my therapist.
All right. You ready to be honest?
I am definitely ready to be honest.
All right. Cool. Maybe you can get some, if the essay becomes relatable for you, maybe you can apply some of those 12-step principles to your alcoholism as well.
It's whatever drug, you know what I mean? I smoked pot and I was...
I know, but Cameron, you're loaded right now, right? And so it's difficult to have a conversation with
him. He's a speech major, Dr. Drew, at the school. Cameron.
Yeah. You go to a meeting. Just go to a meeting. If you can't get an SA meeting, go to an AA meeting.
Yeah.
If you want to do something before it's time to involve yourself at the university, that's something you can do and do now. Get connected with the group. Get a counselor or get a sponsor. Get with the program.
Especially if you're an alcoholic, if your parents are an alcoholic, you have a history of it, it probably means you're an alcoholic, which means it's allergic for you more than other drugs. So if you can just don't drink, because that harms your ability to control yourself too.
And Cameron, hold on one sec. Cameron, I swear to God, I feel bad for you, but if you go and mess around with a prepubescent teen, as you said, dude, do you know how screwy they're going to be? And they're going to have kids at 16 because of you, and then they're screwed up, and the cycle will begin. I will find you, Cameron, and cut your nuts off.
And do you know what they do? Do you know what they do in prison to the guys like that? They're called short eyes, and they are treated the worst of any offender in prison. It is amazing what a short eyes go through. You do not want to be there.
That is James Marsters talking, the knowledge, to my left. He's from Buffy. He plays Spike on the TV show Buffy the Vampire Slayer. Real quick, you're not on WB anymore.
No, we are not.
You have moved to the UPN.
Yes, we have. We are the first show in the history of television to move before being canceled. There was a gentleman's agreement up until now that networks would not buy hit shows after licensing fees contracts expired.
Right.
Even if the shows were hits. Buffy, for reasons that are beyond me, broke the gentleman's agreement, and it is now on a new network.
Does that affect you one bit at all? Do you still tape at the same spot?
Exactly. This is my boss and his bosses and their bosses. And frankly, you know, I know my boss, and he wears khakis and tennis shoes, and he comes down and makes movies with us. And we're at the same locale. We're making the same stories, the same writers. It's the same everything, except my trailer is really big.
Really? Yeah.
we brought down some of the producers and the writers, and we rocked in my trailer, and they're just like, this is incredible.
You like to play guitar,
like,
don't you?
Five amps in my trailer.
You like to play guitar?
Yeah.
What kind of music do you like? What do you listen to?
Oh, God. I listen to Neil Young, Tom Waits, Bruce Springsteen. I like Portishead. I like Morphine.
Favorite band of all time?
Oh,
most talented band of all time.
Do that.
All right, I say Nirvana and Radiohead.
Oh, I disagree with you. Radiohead is way up there. Nirvana is quite a possibility.
Okay.
I would say the Rolling Stones were more seminal, but Nirvana, dude, we're right on the course on that. Radiohead also rocks.
Ah, love them.
Coldplay. If the follow-up album to Coldplay is as good as the first one,
then they're on their way.
Yes.
But you know what? I don't know if you've heard. They are fighting amongst themselves.
No.
Everyone is jealous of the lead singer in that band.
Over.
Apparently,
it's over.
They won't even speak to each
other.
It's
all over.
We'll see what happens.
No, it's all over.
All right, let's go to Angel. You're 16.
Hi.
Hi, you're on LoveLine.
Hello.
Hi.
What's cracking?
What's cracking? Nothing. Yeah. What's your question?
Well, my question was to James.
James.
I was wondering, was playing Spike like your first, what's it called?
Villain?
First choice.
Oh, was that your first choice to be...
My first choice? Man, baby, I came to town. I was willing to be Alf's sidekick. I had been 10 years out in the burbs, in the regional theater. It's not the burbs. It's a respectable form of theater, and you learn how to act there, frankly. And I spent 10 years learning how to act for no money at all. And I finally got sick of it and came to L.A. and decided to get some money. And I lucked out and got a cool guy character.
Now, how'd you get an agent when you moved out here, not really knowing a lot of people? Or did you get discovered while in the theater?
No, I had a friend who was a casting director, man.
Oh, good.
It was, yeah.
Who was your lover for 2 weeks? I'm not sure. No. He's a talented man, this James Marsters.
He's only a friend.
Of course.
He's a good friend.
Right.
Yeah.
Angel, you have any more questions for James?
I don't know. I'm just very happy that I'm talking to him.
Good. Okay, I'm going to put you on hold,
Watch on Tuesday.
On hold the UPN, on 8 p.m.
Of course.
Yeah. All right.
Okay.
Later, baby. Bye. Drew.
Yeah.
Drew, we're doing all right here, right? You being in Sacramento, us down here?
I'm great.
Okay, cool. Anthony.
Hi.
19 on LoveLine.
How are you doing today?
Good.
I'm a big fan of the show.
Cool, man. It's a good show.
So, you want to hear what's wrong?
No, let's put you in. Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, I speed skate for a speed racing team, and when I'm done with my practices or in the middle of my practices, I'll cough up or sneeze up blood. And sometimes I can just
wait.
It to my mouth.
Hang on a second. You will sneeze up blood so it comes out of your nose?
It will come out of my nose or my mouth.
Yeah, but it's something coming down from your nose and then out your mouth.
Yes, and I don't have a bloody nose.
Hmm.
But Drew, if you sneeze, it comes out of your nose.
Yes.
Does it happen once a month?
No, it happens.
You need to have a chest x-ray to make sure this isn't coming from your lungs, because coughing, truly coughing up blood, is actually a very serious problem. I suspect this is just coming from your sinuses. You're speed skating. You're out in the cold, right, skating?
No, I'm inside.
Inside. Is it ice skating, speed skating?
Rollerblading.
So it's, but I just, I, it's probably just the dryness from, you know, going, so, you know, having the air blowing in the sinuses and the little vessel bleeds and you sniff it
is
back
it a lot
and
of blood,
cough
dude?
It out your lung.
Is it a lot of blood? Like,
it can get to be a lot, but it really varies.
Okay. Well, that was a vague answer.
I'm sorry.
That clarifies things. Listen, you said you sneeze and a blob of blood comes out.
Yes.
Yeah. A lot of blood means, you know, people can't, they have to close the restaurant, wherever you are, they have to close the rink down.
Like
because
if you spit into a handkerchief, would it be like filling it up and you need a new handkerchief or just like
blood spots?
It'd be
like if I had a really big bloody nose.
Ooh, that's a lot of blood, though.
That's a lot of blood.
Yeah.
All right. Drew, who does he need to see?
Well, you have to get this checked out.
So
it's very important.
Tonight?
No, unless the bleeding picks up again tonight, or you can go tomorrow, but start with a regular doctor and let's get this checked out.
Regular doctor.
There's sort of unlimited possibilities here. It could be anything.
Okay, good. James Marsters is here. He's hanging out here on LoveLine. Buffy the Vampire Slayer is the show. And
who has these buttons, man?
Anderson.
They can make you seem like an idiot, too, right?
That's
thank
right.
God, you like that, you know.
It's fun.
God,
huh?
I was on time.
Yeah, I would have been yelling at you.
Yeah, and they would be giving to me that, or what, you know, the other
loser.
Button. I shouldn't even remind you of the other buttons tonight because you're so nice to me.
That's right.
Loser.
Who cares? So if you want to talk to James, you can call us here at LoveLine or talk about anything that's going on in your life. Dr. Drew and me, Stryker, and more LoveLine after this.
Hello. This is LoveLine.
1-800-LOVE-191. LoveLine will be right back.
We are back. It is LoveLine. We are having so much fun in the studio. It's practically an orgy. If anyone's around, we're here.
Six are in the studio. We just had to kick them out.
Just kicked out the gear. That's all right. Great. I'm Stryker.
Don't call it LoveLine for nothing.
That's right. For Ace Rocola, James Marsters is here from Buffy the Vampire Slayer, which is on the UPN.
Channel
Tuesdays.
Channel 13 on this in
Los Angeles.
Los Angeles. But
this show is on in like 362 cities.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's so, all around the world. It's a bit freaky, man.
It
is. I went to Australia, New Zealand, and France, and England. And it's like big.
LoveLine?
It's even way bigger. Canada.
Buffy or LoveLine? Oh, Buffy.
Sorry.
Yeah.
We talk about
two. Well, I was saying LoveLine's in that many cities, so it's not just on Channel 13. It could be in Boise. It could be on Channel 9.
You're right.
Idaho Falls,
this
Pocatello,
is what a network
Blackfoot.
Is all about.
Yes. Drew.
Yo.
You're in Sacramento.
I'm in Sacramento at the Zone.
What channel is the? There's the plug. What channel is the UPN on up there?
Hell if I know.
Because you're watching Spanked Revision instead of going.
Oh, I do know. Wait, I do know because the UPN, the local UPN here in Sacramento, part of the gift package I got is a book from the Good Day Sacramento on station 31, UPN.
There you go. You guys know where to go.
Good job.
All right, let's take some more calls here. It's 1-800-LOVE-191. Lola?
Hi.
You are a showgirl. You're 39.
No, I'm not a showgirl.
Okay. We can all hope.
I call for a question that I was already answered, so I wanted to say to James how much I like him. I love this show. I'm so addicted.
Thank you.
Because when I was growing up, there was nothing like that on TV for us.
No, there never was anything on TV like
that. And I'm like so nuts about it. Even though, you know, I'm 39, I should be watching other things. That's
no, you know, one of the things is that I always thought that it was good enough for adults. I get calls from my theater friends all around the country making fun of me, and I tell them to watch a show, and these people are 30, 35 years old. Some
I
of them
know,
are 50 years
it.
Old.
Say,
they
my
love
God,
the show.
I watch it religiously. God forbid I miss the show. I go nuts, and I really love it. And how do you keep white all the time? Don't you regret not being able to go in the sun?
Yes, I do very much. I live right next to the beach, and I can't go to the sun until after the sun goes down. It's in my contract.
Are you serious?
Can you believe this? Yeah.
No,
my skin
no,
tone
no.
has to remain pale.
You yeah. look now.
I haven't been.
You have a little makeup
had
on
a
right
tan
now.
In
right?
5 years, man.
You're tan though to me.
No, I'm just pink.
You are tanner than I am.
No, yeah, you're translucent though, Stryker.
Dude, I'm practically
bare.
Invisible.
I've got no tan line. This
really?
Is just me.
Ah, oh, your lady must love that. Lola, so he's not allowed to go to the beach till the sun goes down.
Yeah.
You probably have a beautiful skin by now.
Yeah, it's
you, know,
you then.
No wrinkles?
No wrinkles at all.
can I give a... I love and talk to you. I wish I could meet you one day, but I know it's impossible. You're so busy. I'm busy too. Can I have a question for Drew real quick?
Yeah, Lola, what's
go
up?
Go ahead.
Drew, real quick. I used to do, you know, occasionally, you know, as a recreation coke in my early 20s, between 20 and 30. I stopped because what it started doing to me... It used to make me hungry and sleepy.
And it gave you the accent.
Well, I'm Italian.
She's
Italian.
Oh,
that's good. Italian is good.
Yes, I know.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Drew, answer the question.
I didn't hear the question.
She said, why is his skin so white?
No!
She said she did cocaine between 20 and 30.
Early 20s and 30s a while ago. I stopped because, and that was a good thing, you started making me hungry and sleepy. That means that the moment I started doing it, I would get hungry, and then I would just go to sleep. I mean, really deep sleep and just sleep so well like a baby. And how could this happen?
I have no explanation.
Coke is so bad for your body, girl. I mean, wipes out all of your vitamins, man. It is like one of the high-grade bad things, man.
Well, she's an Italian. I think she could maybe handle it. I'm 39. I don't know why I even watch the show. I should be watching the other shows on TV.
Susan, put some opiates in there.
Maybe.
No, really. There are other drugs you can do, but Coke is one of the worst ones as far as just biochemically. It whacks out all the vitamins in your body.
But the worst, according to Drew, ecstasy and really? Acid. Right, Drew?
For abuse, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Suzanne.
Yes, hello.
Hello, you're 29 and you're in Sacramento.
Yes, I am. How are you guys doing tonight?
Doing good. How are you?
I'm doing great, thanks.
Good. What's up?
First, I want to make a comment to Dr. Drew. I saw him earlier this evening at Sac State, and it was really great to see him there, and I know everyone had a great time. And
oh, good.
I just want to thank him for that.
That was fun. It was really, tell me something.
Yeah.
I was actually struck by the women in that crowd. I mean, that was the most assertive group. They actually scared me at one point. Assertive group of women I've ever seen at a college crowd. Is that typical of Sac State?
You know, I'm not really sure.
You said Sac.
Are you? Okay, tell me honestly. Are you going to try to pick up Dr. Drew right now?
I'm sorry.
Are you trying to pick up Dr. Drew right now?
I'm not. No.
Okay. We just wanted to know. We had a little bet going over here in LA.
No, I have a question actually. Yeah. I know that wet dreams are typically common among men, and I don't know. I guess maybe among young men
through puberty, Suzanne.
Okay. I'm curious about is it possible for women to have wet dreams?
Yeah, they will. Women have sexual dreams where they will orgasm. They don't necessarily emit anything, so they're not truly wet, but they will have orgasm sometimes. The thing with men is men have a need to release. Stuff builds up, has to come out. And if they don't get a pattern going in their life of masturbation, the God will release it for them during the night.
Suzanne, masturbation. You know what?
Like
let's
one
just
of those
stand
hoses.
Up and say it. You know, it's the male right.
If you tie the hose up, Suzanne, it's going to burst.
Yeah.
And if you don't masturbate for a week, in the middle of the night, that thing is going to burst.
Yeah. I see. That makes sense. So is it common for, I don't know, would they have to stimulate it physically?
Nope.
Or is
nope.
it something that it just happens?
It just happens.
Are you looking to have a wet dream?
With women, are you actually wet at night?
This isn't a question coming from me personally, but it was just something that my boyfriend and I were talking about. We got on the subject about it, and we were kind of stumped. I'm like, maybe we should ask Dr. Drew.
it happens. Women start to get those a little later, too.
Really?
Yeah. They're sexual dreams. That end in climax sometimes.
Okay. Do men typically have more sexual dreams than women? Or
yes.
They do.
And they, again, if they're not sort of cleansing themselves of their buildup, it comes out.
Drew, what's the last sexual dream you had? When?
Oh, I can't remember.
Oh,
I literally can't remember.
Doctors. James, how about you?
I live one.
You see, really he's on Buffy and he comes up with lines like that. Oh, my God.
Sweden.
All right, Aaron, you're 21. What's up? You're on LoveLine.
Hey, guys.
Hey.
First of all, I want to say, James, you're my favorite person in the entire world.
I have no idea what to say to that, but thank you. There are 500 people making me look cool, honey, and it takes that many.
You're an amazing actor, and you're very cool in person.
Thank you, but they do cut out the crappy parts. They really do.
No, but in person especially, you're very humble. I had the pleasure of meeting you a couple of times. And
thank you.
Very cool.
Thank you.
Okay, here's my question. I'm with my boyfriend. We've been together for 2 years. We've been living together for about a little over a year, and I've noticed, like, for the last, I'd say, 6 months to 8 months, first of all, I don't get very aroused. I never really want to have sex, but when we do, things will be going great. And then one little thing, like, if he pulls my hair wrong or something, he scratches me wrong, I'll get just completely angry or I'll start to cry, and I just will not want to have sex after that. Mm-hmm. I just completely get absolutely angry, and I have no idea why.
Hmm.
Is this the first time this has happened to you when you've had a sexual partner?
No, it's not.
You got to give us some hints. I mean, what is this? Does this recall some?
I don't know. Like, everything, you know, we'll be getting into it, and I'll be in the mood, which it takes me a while to get aroused anyway with him, and then.
Are you on any medication?
I was on Buspar because I have anxiety and panic disorder.
Right. Where does that come from?
My mom has it. My grandmother has it. I have three aunts in my family that have it as well, but I don't know if it's completely genetic. It definitely affects my life, but I'm not on anything at the moment. I was on Merced birth control for about, I'd say, a good year, and then I just stopped that, and I'm changing birth controls right now.
What do you want to know?
I'm going to try orthotricycline.
Okay. You haven't started it yet, though.
I haven't. It's been about a month that I've been off.
It might be that Merced, because that sometimes women get... Do you notice any difference when you started the Merced?
I didn't really... But the reason why is because with my last boyfriend, that happened, too, and I wasn't on any birth control pills.
Wait, Aaron, yeah. Hold on. You've been with this guy 2 years, but you said it's been happening only the last 6 to 8 months, but then it happened with another boyfriend before.
The guy I was with before him, I was with for 2.5 years.
Well, what was happening the first year and 4 months of this
relationship? Me and my boyfriend now?
Yeah.
Everything was fine. I mean, the sex was good.
Maybe you're just not into this relationship.
Right, that's what I'm getting at.
I know that you guys would say something like that. I don't know. I mean, I love him. I know you guys... Drew said something about that book, but I love him or something because I love him.
But that's right.
I imagine myself with him forever, and I swear to God, there's nothing wrong with this relationship. And it's happened to me before.
You hate the sex. Of course there's something.
Yeah, I mean, that's the thing.
There are
people that press certain buttons in you, and that's what turns you on, you know?
Yeah.
And you just have to go over to that, as long as it doesn't lead you into being with people that hurt you.
Yeah, you know? He's a great guy, but yeah. I mean, I'll have...
But a great guy doesn't always... turn you on.
Right. The thing is, too, is I have, like, literally, like, 3 or 4 nights a week, I'm having all these sex dreams, and I'm completely turned on in these sexual dreams.
Are they about him?
What?
Are they about
no.
him?
No.
They're about actually, you, James.
You want to hear something?
Yeah.
It's so embarrassing. I swear to God, they are mostly James. Swear to God.
Yes,
James. I sound like I'm some little teenager. I know, but no, but...
Thank you, babe.
I wake up, and I have this feeling of, like I'm sad when I wake up from these dreams.
Aaron, this does not sound good. Right?
Good for you.
This is not good.
I know, I mean, I'm young, you know, but I've always been like into the committed relationship. Like my parents are still together; they're great together.
Yeah, that's fine. That you be a committed relationship, but you don't. This relationship doesn't have to be the one you spend the rest of your life in.
I know.
And there's your body's telling you something. You've got to, you know, part of having anxiety disorder, I believe, is having sort of insufficient competencies of self. You don't manage your internal emotional world well. Your self is not fully developed, so you just sort of left anxious. You can't manage feelings very well. And part of that is not really knowing what you feel. And I think you're sort of detached from things, and you really don't know what the hell's going on here. So you've got to figure out, and maybe some therapy and less medication might do you some world of good here.
A lot of therapy, I think.
Yeah, and you know, you have a life plan and everything and what you always wanted for your life, but you have to look at who you are living with, too.
Drew.
But she doesn't even know who she is. That's the problem. She doesn't know what she wants. She doesn't know what she's feeling.
Woo! James is stripping down. Hey, what's the language?
Shut
up. He said fuck, Andrew said fuck.
Woo! Look at dog over there checking it out. I'm sorry, James.
What just happened?
I took off my coat.
And he is wearing a wife beater tank top, this black one. The man's got muscles on his muscles. He's turning red. You're turning violet. Violet?
I'm putting it back on.
No, leave it off. Leave it off.
I'm going to sit here in my own stink.
I'll take off my... No, I won't. I can't do that. All right, let's grab a call here. Hey, Olivia. Olivia?
Yeah?
What's up? You're 14 on LoveLine with James Marsters from Buffy.
First of all, I wanted to say, Mr. James, you are God because you are in any way involved in Buffy, and anyone involved in Buffy is God.
Yeah, it's true, man. Anybody who gets to come to Sunnydale gets, you know, powdered with the fairy dust.
Olivia, hold on. James, if it takes just to, you know, to get on Buffy, you're God. Maybe there's like one line in there for me to be like, sir, where's the taxi cab? Then I'm God. I'm in. I'm
you
golden.
Would be for people. You'd be like, you're the guy in the taxi cab.
Exactly.
You would be for the rest of your life.
Taxi cab, Ted Stryker. Yeah. All right, Olivia.
Like Spock, Gilligan, and you.
Right.
The taxi cab.
Right, exactly. Yeah. What's your question, Olivia?
Okay, well, I kind of think I'm bisexual, but I'm not sure if it's just like a passing phase or if I am, and I don't know.
14.
Hey, Olivia.
Yeah?
At 14, don't try to figure it out. Just sit by and don't do anything. Just listen. Just watch your feelings. See what happens.
Okay.
Don't That's act. Simple. Don't act. Just cool out. See what happens.
Okay.
Have you ever kissed a girl, Olivia?
No, but I've never kissed a guy either.
Well,
good.
Bisexual.
Good. Well, hang out till you're about 18, and then you'll know what you're doing.
Okay.
Yeah, just by experimenting, you tend to add to the confusion and not figure it out. Just listen to your feelings for a while.
Very good, Drew. 1-800-LOVE-191 is the phone number. You know what? We have to take another quick break. James Marsters is here, as I mentioned, from Buffy. If you want to speak to him, you can call up the program. I'm Stryker, in for Adam Carolla. You don't need to talk to me. Dr. Drew is up in Sacramento. It's very odd not looking at the man, him being way up in Northern California.
He seems really important, doesn't he? He's a disembodied voice. You know?
I'll bet you he's wearing
like Charlie from the Angels thing.
Hey, Drew, are you wearing a blue tie?
No.
No.
Damn it.
Where are my usual
girls,
pajamas?
I have a mission for you.
All right. I'm going to mess with James and his body and his tank top. And more Loveline is coming up after this, mofo.
You're gay.
You know what I'm saying out there?
Adam and Dr. Drew will be right back on Loveline. 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 Loveline.
I am Liquid 82. All right, this is Loveline. I feel like I am on speed, Dr. Drew, and I'm not.
Are you sure?
Yeah, well, yeah. I mean, I worked, did my radio show out here before the Loveline, and man, I sped here, was driving, I was waving at people. Here I am. All right, Adam Carolla is going to be back on Sunday, you guys, so you can talk to him then. And Drew and James is here from Buffy, plays Spike. And did you film today, or did you read lines today? Did you do anything for the show today before you came here?
Oh, God, it all fits in together. Yes, I was shooting a crossbow right at the camera crew, 5 inches away.
Nice.
And they put, you know, like a furniture pad with a big X for me to point at, and I was actually hitting the tape, because, you know, the camera crew was nervous.
Of course.
It's a crossbow, you know.
Right, right.
So they, like, put Bin Laden, you know, on a little thing, you know, trying to help me out.
But
I hit the tape.
I
hit the tape 3 out of 5 times.
Good
actually
for you.
Hit the tape, yeah. So
what time is it the norm on your TV show, Buffy, for you guys to be on set? Is everyone at a different time normally, or? Mm.
The only person who really carries the full load would be Sari herself. She's there
Sarah?
Pretty much all the time, yeah. I mean, she's in every scene, so.
Yeah. Right. Does Freddie Prinze Jr. loiter around?
Yeah, totally.
Does he eat all the food in the...
crafty.
Yeah, craft services.
Good crafty.
His baseball movie
the egg rolls, mother...
Whoa!
James!
James is on fire, you guys.
Did he catch himself or did Anderson do that?
He caught himself. He caught That's himself. Good. He did not say it. I promise he did not say that.
I'm sorry.
Don't worry. Hey, no, you're fine. You're all good. You're all good. Turn hey, Kate. Kate,
hey.
What's up? You're 14. You're on Loveline. James, you didn't say it. Forget it.
I know. I said the first half.
Yeah. What's up, Kate? Go ahead.
James, I was just wondering if you're ever coming to a ballet school. It's called Westside Academy of Dance to rehearse.
I haven't. No, I'm not planning to do that. Although it sounds like a cool thing to do. I'm basically, you know, my butt is Buffy's, and they have me all the time, and I'm always in Sunnydale. What was there a rumor like that or something?
Yeah, well, Sarah Michelle Gellar just came yesterday, and I got her autograph, and I was, like, shaking for the next 20 minutes.
Man, no, I'm not going there. She's a dancer, though. She dances cool. She was showing me some of the moves for the upcoming musicals, and she dances sexy, man.
Yeah.
She's
great
got the
actress.
Whole hip grind thing down. She, yeah, man. She's like, shows Britney Spears what to do.
And for a minimum $20, she'll come to your trailer.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, Sarah. I should not. That's not good.
Freddie Prinze is a lucky man.
He's going to beat me up.
Yeah, he's going to hit me with a chainsaw.
I love the true Hollywood story of his dad. Like, they were like best friends with Tony Orlando. They hung out together. You know his dad, right? From Chico and the Mia, the whole story.
Yeah.
It's amazing.
Mona, 18.
Thank you, Drew.
Keep you focused, Stryker.
I'm focused.
Hey.
Go ahead, Mona.
Hi. I've never had a healthy relationship, and I'm only really attracted to guys that are like 40 and over, and I'm really
worried. Are you
trying
to recapture a dad that left you long ago?
No, he's actually still in the picture, but he was a workaholic. And so we never really, I mean, I haven't, he's really been around.
Don't confuse people actually physically leaving with being emotionally abandoning. A dad who is a workaholic, who is on drugs or using alcohol, who is a rageaholic, who just doesn't respect you or empathize with you or is not available to you in ways that you need, that's an abandoning dad.
Hmm. Well, also, I had a father of a friend make a pass at me when I was 10, and so I'm really worried because I find myself repeating patterns of behavior that I'm almost searching out these kind of guys that are just scum, and I'm really completely unattracted to guys my age.
Where do you meet 40-year-old men?
Like at concerts and clubs and stuff.
So, but you go. They're always scum. You never need. Never meet a nice 40-year-old. Well, I guess yeah.
No.
A 40-year-old will go with an 18-year-old, though. Yeah, almost by definition, it's disturbed. But listen, Mona. You understand what this is. You don't like that you do it.
Right.
There's a certain point where it's just, you got to look at your behavior and just cut it out. You know what I'm saying? You've not given me any sort of emotional motivation for this. It's a compulsive behavior that you know is destructive and you know needs to stop. Go ahead and stop.
Go out with a 32-year-old man. And then go out with a 28-year-old man. Then
you're a 28-year-old even, yeah.
12-step program.
40-year-old men, no offense to them, aren't hip to what the 18-year-olds are into, except having sex with you, Mona.
Yeah. Come here and give me a hug, yeah.
Well, the thing is, I also seem to really attract this type of guy. I mean, like, I had a drunk guy come up to me and telling me what a loser he was and how I was so nice to be talking to him, and I really felt bad. And so it's really hard for me to disassociate from that.
Your dad, what's up with your mom? What's she like?
My mom and I have a really close relationship.
So close that you have an eating disorder?
Well, I did, but...
True, it's unbelievable.
Dang.
Yeah, that's called an intrusive relationship. That's not a close relationship. When your mother's crawling down your throat, whatever, she can't do anything. You can't do anything without having her involved with it or thinking about her. Yeah. That's not parenting. So you don't get, you have a dad who's not available and abandons you. You have a mom who intrudes and doesn't give you an opportunity to develop any sense of yourself. No wonder anyone that comes up to you and shows attraction, you're swept into that relationship. You have no boundaries.
Yeah.
James, how smart is that man? He just hit it right on the head.
I'm just
awed. That was great.
You know, I'm just picking my jaw up off the floor.
That was
great.
What
did you do for your eating disorder?
I was actually hospitalized because...
And are you still working a program?
No. I kind of finished it, and I went from being bulimic to being extremely fat. So I'm working on that, kind of one thing to another.
In the program?
Yeah. So, because I gained all the weight back and then some and started emotionally eating. So I'm working on that right now.
But with the therapeutic team?
I'm still in therapy, yeah. I actually just went back in this year.
This is the therapy for the eating then, right?
It's therapy kind of for all around.
For everything. Good. It all goes together. Are you talking to your therapist about this compulsion with the older man?
No, I haven't. I haven't brought it up yet.
Okay. Do you trust them? Do you trust the therapist?
She's been...
That's a really powerful answer.
That's cool. Yeah, that is cool. Mm-hmm. Listen, tell her about this.
Okay. Can I just say one thing?
Yeah?
James, you're about the sexiest thing on two legs. I am such a huge fan, and you could bite me any day.
Mona, have you seen Dr. Drew lately?
Yeah, he's looking pretty good.
Now all of a sudden you snapped into normality, Mona. So quit sleeping with the 40-year-old. Talk to the therapist and let it out to her, okay?
Sleep with the 120-year-old vampire.
The good news is, Stryker, is I have to be a loser 40-year-old.
No, you do.
See?
But you're not. You're on the ball.
Well, that's why I'm not attracted to her.
Exactly.
So is it good news, bad news?
Hey, Lyle.
Yeah?
What's up? You're 14 on LoveLine.
Yeah. I have she's almost 13, my girlfriend, and I'm almost 15. Is that okay?
Unacceptable. No, it's, it's all right.
That's fine.
What'd you guys say?
Yeah, that's fine.
Do you have a erratic life with your mom and dad? They're still together? What's up?
Yeah, they're still together.
Yeah.
No, you're fine, man.
Okay.
You're fine. Just when you're 20, don't go out with a 13-year-old.
No.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right.
All right, Lyle. Have fun in Wisconsin.
Thanks.
All right. We have time to take one more.
No.
Now we're going to take a break, Drew?
Yeah.
Is your pager going off?
No, but it's 53 is our official break time.
All right, all right, all right. That is Dr. Drew up in Sacramento, so it's kind of odd for us down here. James Marsters is here from Buffy the Vampire Slayer. I'm Stryker, and I'm the loser around here. We got more Loveline coming up after this.
Okay, so I know there's nothing wrong with me. So what's up?
So I was like you, and I used to think that these datelines were totally cheesy.
Why can't I meet anybody?
But I tried everything else and thought, what the hell? So I called the dateline and actually met a cool guy.
I called the dateline and I hooked up with some cool people.
Believe it or not, other normal people are out there looking too.
877-889-DATE.
1-800-LOVE-191. We'll be right back.
Hello, it's Stryker with Dr. Drew on Loveline. And we're here. I'm so confused, I don't know what I'm doing.
You're covering well.
I want to just tell everyone that's been calling into Loveline, I've been filling in since Monday. Thank you so much for being so cool calling in, because I know, you know, my main man Mayonnaise, Adam Carolla, has been doing this thing for so long, get used to him. Don't worry, he's coming back on Sunday. And you guys calling have been so nice to me, not like, you suck, get the hell out, I love Adam! Like, even some emails I get when I check them, so nice, and I appreciate that. And,
big whoop.
I know. Shut up, Carolla, hairy bastard. Put that on a loop, Anderson. He's already doing it! Dr. Drew.
You.
You doing all right up there?
Yeah, great.
Okay, very good.
I'm telling you, it's like gifts, and it's just a wonderful place here at the Zone.
It's like being on Hollywood Square is like that kind of gift?
Not quite that lavish.
Okay, damn it.
Much more meaningful gifts,
right.
Personal gifts.
Do you have two beds, or do you have one big bed?
One big one.
Oh, you got a good bed. That's a nice room.
Yeah. That's a nice thing.
Very nice.
If you guys watch Buffy the Vampire Slayer, well, you're in luck, because one of the big stars from that show, he plays Spike. James Marsters is here, and he's been on fire since he's been here. He's been wearing a tank top. He's got blonde hair. It's all over the place.
You're gay.
He's got the jacket back on.
He's got the jacket back on now. All right, let's go to Jeff at 1-800-LOVE-191. You're 20. What's up?
I was just wondering... if there's anything maybe psychologically wrong with me, or, you know, what I could do to help cope with the fact that my girlfriend slept with more people than I did, and I have, like, trouble dealing with that.
Why?
Why?
Yeah.
I don't... Maybe it's because I've...
And by the way, why did you get into the details? Why did you start having the little tally? What? That's not your business.
How many BJs has she given? That's more important. Have you seen Clerks? The girl's like, I've only slept with five guys, but I've given, 860 BJs.
Everyone you know.
More mystery, less history.
Yeah.
That's a good one.
All right, Jeff, this is not your business. This is her past. If you care about her, she's the person she is because of whatever has gone on in her life to this point.
Think of it as she was looking for you, and she found you.
And by any means, nine is... a lot, but believe, that is not a ton, Jeff.
Around here, baby, that is a weekend. Well,
yeah,
sorry.
I hear the callers that call in. Last night was 25.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So,
is there anything I could do to cope with it, maybe? Any references Drew can give me?
No, you're trying to sabotage this relationship. What are you doing?
Well, no, I'm trying. It's just, it bothers me because it's like, I don't know, it feels like she doesn't feel as strongly about sex because a lot of them were like, one-week things, and, you know, and it's like...
Are you afraid that she's more experienced than you are and you're not going to be able to live up to something else she's been through?
It's not that at all. It's just like I'm very strongly moral when it comes to sex.
How many women have you been with?
Six.
Six.
There's not a giant difference between six and nine.
I know there's not a huge jump. I know. That's why it's bothering me so much.
I don't know what's going on with you, Jeff, but there's something much, much more substantial than just a numbers game. And I don't know why. It seems to me you're just looking to sabotage this relationship. Mm-hmm. Well, do you have a problem with intimacy? Do you have difficulty staying in stable relationships?
No, I've had actually a couple one-year relationships, a couple for about 10.
But is Jeff, do you always...
this one that's extra scary?
I don't know what it is with this one. I mean, maybe it's just that it's she's really good, and maybe it's like scaring me that, you know, I found someone really, you know, better than the other ones, you know?
Jeff,
can't put my finger on it.
Try to step out of yourself for a minute and like, okay, she's been with 9, I've been with 6. That is nothing, man. Forget about it. That's so easy to say, but it seems you're just, there's something else going on. There's got to be. You think so, Drew?
I have no doubt. He is looking to sabotage this relationship.
He's looking for a reason to break up with her. Man. If it wasn't it would be her, the way she dresses or something. Man.
Anyone hearing your story looks at it and just says, what in the hell are you talking about, Jeff?
Especially if she's good in bed. Dude, if she's good in bed, that's a good thing.
And she's probably been with more than 9.
Here's what a lot of guys
flip. You know the rule of 3, right?
That's right. I've seen American Pie, too.
I really think a lot of men are fearful of women's sexuality generally. That they're afraid of being consumed by them or sort of lost in it, or that it's sort of going to run amok some way and they're going to have no way to control it. Men are fundamentally fearful of women's sexuality. And if she is open with that and expresses that freely to you, that's tough for you to take, obviously. And you've begun to focus on it as the fact that she's had a couple of extra experiences is the reason why. It's not the reason why. And it's not a bad thing that she is the way she is. But if you can't handle it, that's your problem.
All right, Jeff?
All
right. Be lucky that she's honest with you.
Definitely. Dr. Drew, do you know what the rule of 3 is?
No.
All right. If a guy says he slept with 9 women, he's really only slept with 3.
Yeah.
If a woman says she slept with 6 guys, then she slept with 18.
18 guys.
Right.
Good times.
So basically,
men multiply, women divide.
Exactly. Holly.
Yes.
Hi there. You're 27. What's going on?
I have a weird question, actually.
Not a weird one.
By the way, I love the show. I love it. I have to stay up really late to hear it, though, because they replay it here. So.
Where do you live?
Whatever.
Hawaii. In Hawaii. Okay, cool.
Mm-hmm. My question is, it's about anal sex.
No.
Yeah. I heard Dr. Drew say a couple days ago that it was dangerous. I mean, it's obvious, you know, about... you know, diseases and all that kind of stuff. But if you're in a committed relationship with someone, you're monogamous, you both don't have a disease, is it dangerous then?
It's not dangerous. It's just that it's not the healthiest activity. I mean, people get... What you don't understand when you're a nice, young, healthy adult is that that part of one's body can be fraught with pathology later on in life. Tears and abscesses and all kinds of wonderful things can happen. And this can, you know, this can accelerate that and predispose to that. But, you know, it's not a terribly unhealthy action. It's nothing that you can't do or should avoid if it's something you as in your monogamous relationship want to do.
Is it something that he wants to do and you want to please him, or do you want to do it too?
A little bit of both, actually. Mm-hmm.
Have you done it before?
I did it with a previous boyfriend, but he was not as...
hung?
Yeah.
Okay. I hear you, baby.
Yeah, so, I mean, it was okay with him. I mean, it was painful, but then it was all right, and then I liked it.
Buy some lubricant and be careful.
I've had anal sex.
Drew, you have?
Of course.
That's
disappointing.
All right, Holly, is that it?
I did have one small other question.
Yeah.
In my past relationships, I'm sexually experienced, and I've been with a couple guys, and I've always enjoyed performing oral sex.
Yes.
And... you know, I've never had a problem with it before. Well, with this boyfriend, he likes it, but he doesn't finish, and he says he's never finished, and I've tried everything I can think of, and I don't know, like, is that just him?
Okay, sometimes it hurts to finish in the mouth.
And some guys don't like to finish that way.
It does. They just, yeah.
And they just don't like, they just have a preference. It's not, they miss that engagement with you in a more intimate way, or what they perceive as a more intimate way.
Speak for yourself, Drew.
I'm just saying that's how that works.
Holly, I'm Stryker, and we're in L.A. Airplanes, baby.
If you ever break up with your boyfriend.
I got a woman, so that wouldn't work. But still, God bless you, Holly.
I love her very much.
I love your attitude, your personality. God bless you. But do not hold it against yourself that he cannot ejaculate when you're doing that, okay?
That's not like I'm doing something wrong.
Not at all.
No.
Not at all. Okay.
Hey, Holly, in general, I think you're way too preoccupied with the other person. You need to be a little more present yourself. Okay? If things that aren't good for you, if you don't like it, it doesn't feel good, you don't have to do everything for the other person, okay?
Now, James.
Yes.
That's your kind of woman if you were a woman, man, woman, right?
In can you be more obscure?
Charity, you're 16.
Hello.
Hi, what's going on?
Well, let me just say, I know you always hear these like little we love you type things, but I'm not going to single anybody out, but all of you guys are so awesome. I love the show. I don't know what I'd do without you guys. Seriously, I listen to it every night, and I'm like, okay, I need that part of advice. So just want to say thanks.
Cool, thanks.
Okay, I'm probably one of the only virgins who have ever called this show, but I'm kind of having a problem with that. Okay, there's this guy, and, okay, well, about a year ago, I was with this one guy, and he seemed to be, you know, all great, perfect, blah, 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 even though he was with 12 other girls at the same time. So I kind of have bad...
He sounds just perfect, Charity. Perfect guy. What a swell dude.
I know. He was kind of a jerk. But yeah.
What a cute jerk.
He was perfect.
He was cute.
No, actually, he wasn't. But he was sweet. I went for the personality for once, and he turned out to be a complete jerk. I don't know.
Slick.
I have this bad luck with guys, but...
No, luck has nothing to do with it.
Really?
It's your choices.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
It's what your brain has turned... whatever traumas you've been through into attraction. And now you're attracted to these guys that are abusive a-holes.
Yeah.
Right?
I figured that one out.
What happened to you?
Well, he broke up with me. And,
no, no, no. You know, what happened to you that made you so attractive to victimizing guys?
You know what? I don't know. I just, like, for some reason they come off to me as, like, perfect, and then they're...
No, what happened to you earlier? What happened to you? Were you traumatized in some way?
Well, I have this depression problem. I'm really depressed all the time.
Yeah.
Like, I feel like if I don't have a guy with me, then I'm just, like, totally going to break down. Because I always feel like I have to be able to, you know, go to somebody and they can wrap me in their arms and tell me.
Were you raised in an environment of substantial, of serious chaos?
My dad, he's German, so he has one of those tempers that when he gets mad, he, like, freaks.
Did he hit you?
Mm-hmm. He, like, long time ago. He hasn't done it for... like 6 or 7 years, but
when it really counts, 6 or 7 years ago? When it really counts, Charity, is a long time ago.
That's
when your brain's developing. That's when it has the most profound effect on you.
Did he hit you a lot then?
Not very much, but enough to where I was scared of him most of my life.
And that's what's causing you to find these a-holes now.
That becomes attraction once you hit puberty.
Really?
You start looking. You're trying to make that right. You're trying to that's your model for the person you love is that physically abusive, abandoning dad.
And you figure if you can make it work with that guy, you can fill the hole that you feel because you're dead.
Well,
that's crazy. Well, see, I'm kind of having fun with this guy now. But see, I was like, after that one guy broke up with me, I was single for a full year, and for me, that's a long time because usually before I was just date everybody, go out with everybody, you know, whatever. And after him and I broke up, there were so many guys that liked me and whatnot, and I was just like, no, you know, I want somebody that's, you know, worth my time this time. I'm actually going to, like, let them come to me. And I met this guy, and he was, like so perfect. You know, I knew his reputation. It wasn't bad. I knew a lot of the ex-girlfriends and whatnot, and he just seemed perfect, you know. And I ran into him one night, and we just hung out a little bit after that, and he... you know, eventually started kissing, and he would call me whenever he told me he'd call me, which is a rare thing for a guy to do that I know of. And
thank you, Anderson.
Hold on. Where are we going with this, Charity?
Charity, I give you 5 seconds to spit out a question, or I'm going. Get to it. Well, come on, baby.
He kind of, after a while, he kind of just left, and then his friends said that I can't get him back unless I had sex with him.
All right, well, so you found another one, Charity. Good job.
I know, but it's like one of those, like, I can't, like, go on. Like, I've been waiting here for a month just thinking about it.
Charity, you're 16, and you're on edge to lose your virginity. You don't need to do it, especially with an imbecile like this dude.
Anybody who tells you, have sex with me or else I won't do that, don't have sex. Go find some nice guy.
He has proven himself to be yet another one of these a-holes
Bingo.
That you keep finding.
He's an idiot.
He's a little lighter version of it. You're moving up the scale. Good. Let's get back out there and find somebody better.
Definitely. All right, we're moving on. Drew, I think this question is going to be for you. She's been waiting forever, so I'm grabbing her. Jenna, you're 21. What's going on?
Hi, boys. How are you tonight?
We're good.
Good. You guys rock. I'm so happy. Yay. Cool. Okay, let me give you a little medical history. I'm polycystic. And Drew, you know what that is.
What does that mean,
yes.
Drew?
It's a particular syndrome. Are you overweight, too?
No.
Do you have insulin resistance at all? Do you have blood sugar problems?
No, I was diagnosed.
Do you have polycystic ovarian syndrome, or did you have an ovary with some cysts on it?
They said I was polycystic, but I did have my right ovary had to be removed because I had like a baseball size, like cysty tumory thing on it. So I've been going to the doctor since I was 9 for that.
I've
dealt with this for a while. But
was it a dermoid cyst?
I don't know.
All right, go ahead.
So I had that removed when I was 13, and recently, I guess about in like January or February, I started getting a lot of pain on my right hand side, and especially during sex. Like the first time it actually happened, my boyfriend and I were having sex, and all of a sudden I was just on the floor screaming and panting, and like, I want to be panting, but I don't want to be screaming, you know what I'm saying? So it's, you know, it just was killing me, and I thought it was just a muscle spasm. I went to my doctor right away. He didn't know what it was, and we did all these tests because it kept happening, and he found that there was scar tissue because you can't see it through, like, an ultrasound or any of these tests, so they had to go in there, and they found that, and they said it's supposed to get better, and it hasn't. Like, at first it did, and now I keep having this, and it's like I can't have a regular sex life without pain.
Or convulsing.
Like,
so what do you do about scar tissue? Can you get that removed, Drew? Can you have
that? Well, that's what they did when they did the laparoscopy, I'm sure. Right. But it does tend to come back. Did they treat you for an infection at all? Was that a concern?
No, they didn't. I mean, I asked my doctor about it recently, too. I'm like, why is this happening again? And he's like, well, I don't know what to tell you. You're just going to have to, like, not do it as hard.
Are you real active sexually?
Yeah.
Is your boyfriend large?
Yeah.
Well,
yeah, he's a big boy, but like,
I mean, he's giving you a clear direction, which is that you have an inflamed area there that tends to form scar tissue. You have to pay attention to it, just like if you had a leg injury and you insisted on going out and going running every day.
Well, no,
there's certain injuries that you preclude vigorous activity.
Well, we've been very careful about it. And, you know, if I feel it hurting, you know, we'll stop or we'll, like, ease back. But it's like, well, am I ever going to get to the point where I'm not going to have to worry about it? Because I can't enjoy sex anymore.
Because you're worried it's going to hurt?
Yeah.
I'll, like, hold him and, like, it's, like, gotten to me, like, emotionally now. I'm just afraid it's going to hurt. So it's like I'm not even.
Do you have a sexual abuse history?
No, not at all.
Okay. Then it should get better. I mean, that kind of thing shouldn't persist at that same level of intensity unless the scar tissue comes back, in which case you can go back in there and have it taken out again. They didn't see any endometriosis when they were in there?
No, they checked for that, but they didn't. They didn't see
it. Listen, pelvic pain is a very, very difficult problem, and it's hard to nail down sometimes. It's hard to know exactly what's causing it. The reason I ask about sexual abuse is that's a very, very common cause of unexplained pelvic pain.
Yeah.
And sometimes it gets sort of triggered off by an organic cause. Like, you have a real cause of the pain, then all of a sudden everything gets going, and you're stuck with pain. But I would suspect, it sounds like this is the kind of thing that should get better, but you're going to have to be very cautious with it. It may get stirred up very easily.
I mean, he goes out of town a lot, so it's like we can't be that active all the time because he's not here, so.
Well, just mellow it out, Jenna, okay?
It's hard to, you know?
I know. Well, maybe you can just, how about the oral thing? Why doesn't he just start doing oral for a while?
I know, but, okay.
All right.
Stryker the pragmatist.
That's right.
Really, man. Yeah. Fingers in the oral, man. Yeah. It can work nice.
All right, Jenna. You have a great personality, by the way.
Oh, thank you. I have one other little tiny question.
Ah, get to it.
I'm sorry.
Sorry.
Since I do only have one ovary, and I know that it's not supposed to, like, have a problem with bearing children and everything, but since I do have polycystic disease and I was put on birth control to, like, help that, when I get off the birth control, are the cysts just going to come back? Because if I'm trying to have kids and cysts keep growing on.
I have to tell you, that whole diagnosis of polycystic ovarian disease is questionable to me. I think you may just be somebody that forms follicular cysts. and that will not impair fertility. And whether it's PCO or just simple cysts, they do tend to come back.
See, James, when calls come in about that, we just kind of, at least I just kind of lay low, maybe jump in now and then. Drew does his thing. When we get calls about the penis falling off, that's when we can jump in and screw around for a while.
That.
Exactly. Yeah. All right, Gene.
Yes.
What's up? You're 24 on LoveLine. James Marsters is here, you guys, from Buffy, which is on the UPN now Tuesdays. Go ahead, Gene.
Hey, James. Hey, Stryker. How are you guys?
What's up?
Doing good.
Don't want to leave you guys out, but this question's mainly for Dr. Drew.
Cool.
Over the past couple weeks, I've sort of come to the realization that I'm not attracted to men, but same token, I'm not attracted to women.
Morrissey.
What?
From the Smiths.
From the Smiths, and later from Morrissey.
Right. He was, what did they call him?
Oh, I feel so sorry for myself.
Yes.
Him.
Very good. Anyway. He's a her, him. He didn't like anything.
Yeah.
Sorry, Gene. Go ahead.
Okay.
Don't mind us. I love crooked penises.
What else going on, Gene? There's a lot more here.
What else?
Come on, what else?
Really, I don't think there's
I mean, you sound depressed, for starters.
Well, I mean, I'm on Prozac.
Okay, well, that can take away your sex drive, like, profoundly.
No, I know it can, because I was on it when I was in high school, so I know that's one of the side effects, but it never was to the point where I just...
What kind of doctor put you on the Prozac?
Just my physician.
They didn't suggest you see a psychologist or psychiatrist?
No.
Maybe that wouldn't be a bad idea, because sometimes, while internists or general doctors are certainly capable of prescribing and monitoring medication... They are not the best at making firm or clear diagnoses about mental health. And maybe there are other things that can be done here to really help you beyond the antidepressant medication. And, by the way, you still sound depressed in spite of being on Prozac.
Okay.
So there's depression that needs probably better management. And secondly, there seems to be something more than just depression going on here that's being undealt with.
Okay.
Right? Right?
I don't know.
I mean, you're having trouble...
Anything else.
Well, you're having trouble with your interpersonal life.
Yeah.
You're empty.
Yeah, I mean, I don't have a ton of close relationships with people. As I've gotten older, I've gotten closer with my family, but I don't have a lot. I don't have tons of friends. I'm realizing that you don't have very many friends in life. You have lots of acquaintances.
That's an odd outlook to me, Gene.
Well, I personally don't find a lot of people I would consider friends.
What about growing up?
I'm going to go back to my original question. Okay. What else going on here, Gene? There's got to be a ton here. What's up?
I don't know. I mean, I...
Come on.
I went back to school, which I was really happy about.
Why did you leave school?
Why? I relocated from California to Arizona. So
why?
At first, it was my stepdad's job.
Your stepdad?
Yeah.
You're 24 years old?
Mm-hmm.
Why are you with your stepdad?
This was back when I was 18. I was still living at home with my parents when I relocated to Arizona. So at first it was just...
Wait, I relocated to Arizona. Your family moved to Arizona?
Yeah.
Okay, I relocated...
Sorry, my family moved to Arizona, so I came out here. So at first it was a matter of waiting till, you know, I wouldn't have to pay out of state.
Where was your biological dad?
He lives in San Diego.
And what's his deal?
We've had an off and on relationship, but I'm, you know, really trying to repair that now.
How old were you when he took off?
My parents divorced when I was 4, and my mom and stepdad have been married for about 18 years. I mean, my stepdad's awesome, so it's not
That's
like
nice.
I didn't have a male figure in my life.
What happened to your dad? What was his deal?
He had drug and alcohol problems, so...
All right,
there you go.
Couldn't work
All right, so it's a big deal.
Yeah.
It's a big deal, Gene. And no one's helping you deal with that. That's a big deal.
Okay.
And by the way, is he in recovery right now?
He actually has been sober for 2 years. He just got remarried about 2 years ago. He's been completely sober. He's really made a huge turn in his life, which I have a lot of respect for.
That's good, and that's great, and I certainly wouldn't be a part of his life unless he was in recovery.
Right.
But without you going to Al-Anon, it could be a pretty confusing experience for you, I think, even still.
All right, so go to Al-Anon. So. Drew, we have to take a break here.
All right.
Do you want to wrap up that call since she didn't want to speak to you? That's it. Go to Al-Anon, and they'll help you out here. All right.
All right.
Jesus. Two really wonderful calls in a row there. James is here. He plays Spike over on the Buffy TV show, which is awesome. Fifth year?
Yeah, as they say in the English theater, attempting the role.
Attempting the role. And you're doing just fine at it.
Yeah.
You and I will fight with the sword outside. And not in the bathroom. I'm Stryker in for Adam Carolla. More Loveline coming up.
1-800-LOVE-191. Back in a minute.
I know the pieces fit. Do you know the song, James?
No, I don't.
Welcome back, you guys. This is Loveline. James Marsters is here from the show Buffy the Vampire Slayer. How did you get the role?
They were scraping the bottom of the barrel. They had looked at a lot of big names and didn't find anybody that could do an English accent. I just lucked out.
Do you do other accents like Australia, like the Croc Hunter?
Yeah, I do basically any accent that you could pay me for. I don't do Thailand. What?
My questions are going to my pecker.
Look at the size of the diamond pick.
Yeah,
it's
baby.
Huge.
Hey, dude. Got the diamond. It's a bacon.
What's it's the gorgeous?
What's the vibe like on the set of Buffy? Everyone get along pretty well.
Yeah,
everyone's cool.
Really well.
Because
the great thing is that Sarah is a complete professional and really nice to everybody, so nobody can be an ass.
Right.
You know,
that's
nobody
cool.
can get away with any bad behavior because she shows up on time with her lines down. She's always nice. She's a complete professional. So
and she is like, the star of the
exactly.
show.
Exactly. So yeah. if she was being a diva, then the rest of the cast could get away with being a little bit of a diva. But because she's not, there's a cap on all that. So it's good. It's very cool.
What Sunny about film? Do you have anything that you want to? I mean, you've done a couple movies.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. They wanted to put me there was serious talk of putting me as a major villain in a new big like $140 movie, man.
$140 million movie.
Yeah, and then
like Freddy Krueger Part 9 or something
movie.
Bigger than
yeah,
that.
Big special effect movie. They want me to do the.
And is that a lock? Is that in? Is that done?
Well, it's kind of a lock. Except they're not going to let me out for it. If I was my
Buffy's not going to let you out to do this.
Right. Well, you know they didn't. You know I'm working for them. Would you let me out if I worked for you?
Well, I would.
Yes, it would help promote everything.
No,
right?
it throws an absolute wrench into the production schedule. It's a headache they don't want.
Can't you film the movie during hiatus? Can't the $150 million movie?
No,
wait. They're not going
to
do it.
No, what will the $150 to $100 million movie wait for me?
Well, to that movie company, this is Stryker. I will be happy to take the role. I can get the hell out of my radio deal.
I can dye my hair.
My hair was almost as blonde as yours a couple weeks ago, but yeah? Spikey, they cut it all off today.
Dude, hurts, doesn't it?
I feel bad, and the guy is
no, like the bleaching hurts.
Oh, I like it. I like because you can get it
well,
spiky.
We should talk about
get
that.
It better. It feels good. It's good stuff.
Good pain.
All right, let's
talk to Jessica. She's Chaos Queen here.
Yeah, we got it hooked up. Jessica, you're 21, Chaos Queen. What's going on?
I need a little advice on a problem I have.
Yeah.
For the past 2 years, my husband has been incarcerated. And about a year ago, I got into a relationship with a girl, and she moved in with me.
Right.
But the problem is, my husband gets out in November, and I don't know how to tell this girl that it's time to go.
What is your husband locked up for?
Hold on. The Loveline answer is parole violation.
No, it was his first offense.
It's mopery. You know what mopery is, Drew?
What's that?
Exposing yourself to a blind person.
Good times.
No,
Jessica, how old is this girl?
She's 23.
All right.
Are you romantically involved with her?
For the past 4 months, no. Because about 5 months ago, I broke up with her, and she tried to overdose on sleeping pills. And I took her to the hospital. They pumped her stomach, and every time I try to leave her, she talks that she's going to kill herself.
Perfectly normal, perfectly healthy.
Mm-hmm. Not manipulative at all.
I mean, she doesn't want to leave.
Have you told your husband about this?
Well, my husband knows.
Yeah, maybe you could enlist his help to manage this.
Drew, come on. He's going to come home. He's going to do something, get thrown right back in the
slammer.
He's
going to kick her ass is what's going to happen.
Are you kidding? This a-hole is going to go for a threesome.
Well, it's not like if he's never done it.
See what I'm saying, guys?
Well,
the
yeah.
The point is, him and his girl don't like each other.
Oh.
Oh. Bad. Well,
okay.
Because I left, well, she used to be the first girl I was with, and I left her for him. But when he got locked up, I got back with her. And they never liked
Jessica, each other. Jessica, what is up with your life? Don't you ever wonder that?
How many kids do you have?
Who, me? None.
I love you, Jessica. You're great. Are you sterile? Do you use birth control? What do you do?
I'm not ready for kids.
Yeah, but how do you prevent it from happening?
She's with a woman, and the woman does not have a wiener.
Thank you, Stryker, for clarifying that.
Who's the doctor around here, Sacramento boy?
But
thank God for Dr. Drew.
But I don't understand how you avoid pregnancy in all this chaos.
And I've been with him for about 6 years.
Right, so what are you doing for contraception?
The shot.
Cool.
You're on Depo Provera shot.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right, Jessica. Seriously?
Keep getting that shot, please.
Yeah, keep taking the shot. Who do you like more, the husband or the woman?
My husband.
All right, well then just bite the bullet, man. And tell her to get out.
Get
if she does
out.
Something bad, she does it. If not...
You know, yeah, you are not responsible for her. If she decides to hurt herself,
your responsibility.
Your fault.
But listen, Jessica, you don't want to be cruel, but if she threatens anything... You call the police.
Yeah,
that's
call
the appropriate response. If she threatens to kill herself,
she left
call
for
the police.
About a week. Mm-hmm. But she went to my mom's house.
What?
And she had my mom calling me, and she was crying, and I mean...
Okay, here, I have it. Move from where you are, and don't tell her where you moved to.
That's a good one. You know, or if she tries to hop herself, you know, call 911 and there will be a psychiatrist that will be given to her.
Yeah, she needs help, Jessica.
But
she really has
to
be
somewhere. On her side.
I said the East Police will come.
She has my family on her side. My family doesn't like my husband. If I were to leave and my family knows, they would tell her where I'm at.
So they...
They want me to be with her.
This is worse than any Ricky Lake, for God's sakes.
They want me to be with her, but I don't want her.
Well, then tell your family you live in a post office box and, you know, they can mail you there and then, you know, live your life if you want to get away from this person. But really, if she's getting you to stay with her by scaring you into that she's going to hurt herself, don't let that work. Don't let her beat you with that.
Because
you know?
My mom told me, she goes, if you stay with him, I'm not talking to you no more. But if you stay with her... She goes, if you want somewhere to live, I'll get you a place, I'll pay your rent, I'll get you a car. She just wants me to stay with her.
Parents will always come back. Parents will always come back.
Just with this brief brush I've had with your description of your mom, I think it might be a blessing if she never talked to you again. So let's get on with things.
For the 2 years that me and that other girl broke up, my mom didn't talk to me. But when I got back with the other girl...
Exactly. Jessica?
Yeah.
Did you just hear what Dr. Drew said 20 seconds ago?
Where are we going to go with this, guys?
Here. Let me say something and you guys just back me up and we'll move on. You're 21.
Yeah.
Do you work?
Yeah.
Use that money. Get your own apartment.
I have my own place. I'm buying this house.
Get a different place.
Yeah. Get away from everybody. Great advice.
Let this psychotic woman hang out with your mom. Don't deal with your mom.
Yeah,
she's psychotic also.
Take that Depo Provera shot, Jessica, and for Christ's sake, don't get pregnant.
My mom is psychotic. She was in prison for 7 years for trying to kill my dad.
Please
there
yourself.
You go. There
Please
you go.
Yourself.
There you go. This mom does not disappoint.
We gave 86 options. Choose one. Use your money. Get another place. And let this psychotic girl go to your mom. You think
was
so,
I
Drew?
Not right?
You were right on.
Call your own shots. Decide who you want to be with and be with that person. Don't let anybody else tell you what to do with that. Right?
Was I not right for calling her the chaos queen?
You're right on, homeboy. Why are you choosing five, Drew?
Because
what are you doing?
He's been on call for hold for an hour.
I know, and I chose two people before the break, and it was like strangling myself, William.
Oh, okay. So put him on hold then.
No, okay. Hold on one sec, William. Let's go.
It's
to,
also a quick one. It's an easy
let's go,
one,
Jim.
Yeah.
What's up, man?
All right. I got a question. This one. Maybe all you guys can field this one. Never really. I listen to you guys' show all the time, and
you what? I'm sorry, I didn't hear what you said.
I listen to the show all the time. Oh. And, you know, people got the same type of issue, at least guys have the same issue, saying that they're not sure if they're bisexual or not. And every time someone says it, you guys say, you know, for sure that they're gay. If you have any bisexual tendencies, they're gay. Right? That's kind of the feeling that I get.
You're gay.
No, that's Adam's thing.
No. Yeah.
There are several.
Kurt Cobain said that everyone is gay.
Right.
So there you got that.
That's actually true. But there are multiple different kinds of that we all have. That if you really study the anthropology and the development of this, we all go through periods of development where we have bisexual or homosexual kinds of experiences or feelings. But be that as it may, Jim, there's several different sort of issues here. One is someone who is transitioning from heterosexual to gay.
Right.
Struggling with that and sort of trying to come to terms with that. There are, number two, people who are sexually confused, who were sexually abused when they were a kid and just their radar's off. They can't figure out what the hell they are, or they have other kinds of psychiatric disturbances that make it impossible for them to develop a mature sexual identity.
Right.
And there are people that are bisexual, which is relatively uncommon, but there is such a thing, that they're a mature bisexual, not confused, that is their sexual orientation.
Right.
But our point with the bisexuality is, it's sort of a technicality, because if you are, let's say you're bisexual, Jim, but you're with a male, what the hell is the difference it makes if you're bisexual or not? You're homosexual now. You're in a committed relationship. You're gay. Or if you're with a girl, you're heterosexual. And who cares whether you're bisexual? You're in a committed relationship.
I can never see myself ever emotionally attaching myself to a guy just because that's... You know, I think I could look at it just like how you guys would too. It just doesn't seem.
See, that's
right
the hardest thing about being gay is really admitting that you are, and then you're gonna have to bite the bullet of undergoing the ostracization and society telling you suck because you're gay.
Faggot.
Nobody really wants to be gay. They always have to face up to it and say, you know what, I'm gay, and I have to tell everybody. And they, you know, they have to be pulled to the realization of it and admitting
it. But gay is a lifestyle commitment. And Jim, I wonder if what you're describing is sort of a fetish.
You know, I think that's like the weirdest thing is like I...
You sounded gay right there the way you just said that, by the way.
Sure, Stryker, nice.
But Jim, how many guys have you been with?
What's that?
How many different guys have you been with?
I mean, being by Ben with is just by actually kissing. I've never done anything more than that.
How many women have you had sex with?
Like 17, 18.
Divided by three, so you've been with six women.
I heard you guys talking about that one. No, that's the truth.
So, Jim, do you think the guy thing can be just sort of a fetish, a little bit of preoccupation?
That's honestly, and that's what I think it is.
I think that's what I think too.
That's what I think.
Yeah.
I think you have a little bit of a sexual compulsive in you, and part of that sort of bleeds into this fetishist. Do you have other fetishes too?
No.
Just guys.
Feet.
Do you ever like cross dress or anything like that?
No.
Nobody wears his mom's panties.
I mean, as much as I could say this, but I'm completely normal. Like you would have.
All right. You know. Well, there you go.
Wait, Jim, I have something just hit me here.
What?
If I was going to be gay, I would be in it to have my wiener touched or for me to do something to him, not for the kissing of the guy. That seems weird that you've only kissed because that seems to me
more intimate.
Yeah.
Yeah,
not nearly as focused a striker as you would be having your wiener touched.
That's right. No, seriously,
Drew.
Usually it's the girls putting them on the brakes anyway. I always thought with two guys getting together, you know.
That's the total opposite. That if you know, because I don't. I guess I maybe my whole look on it. Because I've got a friend who's gay, and he's been trying to tell me whatever, and I just don't agree with anything he says. Like I'm struggling with my sexuality, and I really don't think so. That's why I look at kissing as like. I mean, when it happened, it just, you know, it happened several times, and you know, I was drinking, and I'm not going to use that as a crutch or an excuse,
yeah.
But I just look at it like, that's why I think I agree with you, Drew, is that it's just, maybe it's just...
Fetish.
Fetish.
All right, Jim. Well, you sound fine, except for the making out with men and women, and the 18
and
girls.
I haven't done it, so, I mean, I haven't done it in a while, so maybe it just was...
Jim, good times.
All right.
Relax.
Have fun in the LBC, dude.
Yeah.
Have a good time. All right.
Later.
See you guys later.
All right. Later. This is Love Line.
Oh, yeah,
we have to
have sex with my brother.
Good for you, Jim.
I didn't say that.
No, you didn't say that, James. I was calling you Jim. I was calling that call. Yeah. You like to be called James, all right?
Yeah. Yeah.
What about Sir?
No.
No.
Sir James?
Sir James.
All right. No. If you guys watch Buffy, the man that plays Spike is in the room with me. And I said at the top of the show, I saw him on Kilborn a couple years ago. And you're really the only person I know from the show, not personally, but know as a character because I've I've never seen the show because I'm on the radio when it's on.
No,
every
you
night.
Have a life. You don't watch television. That's good.
Actually, I watch it in the morning when I get up.
Good.
Spice Channel never hurt anybody. Dr. Drew is...
You should watch the show. It's surprisingly good. The name
is, yeah.
Buffy the Vampire Slayer, mm-hmm. My boss is daring you not to be cool enough to check it out because it has such a freaky name. It's got a nerdy name for a reason. I swear to God.
Is Luke Perry still on it?
I'm just kidding.
I'm just kidding. Nine
now
seconds.
Now he rode the bull.
And now he's riding the bull on Oz, isn't he?
Yes, he is.
You should be on Oz. You'd be good on Oz.
Thank you.
You and Luke could pump
you know
each
what
other.
I'd have to undergo on Oz, though. Yeah.
Well, yeah, of course. All right, we got about 20 minutes left at Loveline. If you want to speak to James Marsters from Buffy, you can call us here at Loveline. Hold on.
Loveline. 1-800-LOVE-191.
We are back. It is Loveline, and the song in the background right here is from Puddle of Mud. And Wesley, the lead singer, it's odd you're hearing this in the background. James from Buffy and I were just talking about Nirvana a whole bunch.
Yeah.
And you were in Seattle when Kurt Cobain committed suicide.
Yeah, when it happened.
I think the lead singer of that band has Kurt Cobain-esque voice. Not necessarily in that song we were just hearing, but if you listen to the album,
mm-hmm.
you should check it out.
It's hard
very
not
similar.
To. Whenever I sing Come As You Are, it's hard not to go there. You're trying to do it your own way, but it just, mm-hmm. you know, it sounds better when you try to sound like Kurt.
Yeah. Definitely. So Nirvana, as we talked about earlier, one of your favorite bands, like
absolutely,
like mine.
Absolutely, just seminal, man. Just absolutely rewrote everything, the other Beatles, you know.
Definitely.
Completely notched everything.
If not for Nirvana, we'd still be listening to Poison.
Yes, thank you. Thank you. Big Hair would still be here.
That's right.
You know?
What's your favorite Nirvana song of all time? If there is one, that's very hard. Even if they didn't write it, like on that Unplugged CD. So many good ones.
I'm so happy, 'cause today I found my friends.
Very good.
In my head, I'm so ugly. That's okay, 'cause so are you. Yeah! Sorry.
Oh, very good, James. Singing along here. Good stuff, huh, Drew?
Oh, great. Time's a-wasting.
Oh, my God. Drew, you're still there, aren't you?
I'm here.
All right, yeah, let's grab a couple sleep. Quick calls here before we have to get the hell out of here. Renee, you're 18. Question for Drew real quick.
My question is, what are all the possible ways of chlamydia being transferred to
Drew,
another
What do you mean all the possible? Can you get it from oral sex? Is that the question?
Yeah, well, because...
Yes.
And also here on the computer, it says that contact with the genitals, mouth, or rectal area.
Yes, any mucosal surface.
Don't!
You get it in the eye too.
But
you can.
It's mouth to genital, right? Not mouth to mouth.
Good question. I've never heard of mouth to mouth, but I imagine it could happen.
Okay.
Well, how would you have it in your wait?
Yeah, your throat. It gets in your throat.
Oh, okay, in your throat. Okay, got it.
Okay.
I've never heard of that though.
Do you know someone that's got it, and you're afraid of getting it?
Yeah.
Do you think you have symptoms of it? Is that why you're asking?
Well, I've had. I've been sexual with the guy that has it, and
stinking whore.
And he's been sexual with a couple of our friends too.
Ah.
So we have a big chlamydia tree going on here.
Fabulous.
Yeah.
Get your Azithromax, one dose.
So
one gram.
We're all going to Planned Parenthood tomorrow.
Good.
Get the
good.
One dose and you're done, right, Drew? Is that it? You're done with it?
It's a one dose now.
Drew, what are some of the STDs that stick with you for life? Like warts, right?
Warts actually may burn out after a few years. A certain percentage of the wart viruses actually go away. The ones that persist are the ones more likely to be associated with the cancers, the cervical cancers, that kind of thing. Herpes is with you for good. HIV is with you for good. Hepatitis C, hepatitis B can be with you for good.
But chlamydia, if you take that pill, you can knock it out of you? Is that right?
Yeah, the chlamydia, gonorrhea, non-gonococcal infections, these become sort of quaint sexually transmitted diseases by comparison with what else is out there.
Yeah, but the big one is get to Planned Parenthood. They're good people. They'll treat you well, and they'll not spill your stuff around.
And they pass out mints at the door.
You know, yeah, and they're not that expensive, guys. They go by what you earn. So if you don't earn that much, they won't charge you that much. So go.
Excellent. Crystal.
Hi.
Hi, you're 16 on Loveline with James Marsters from Buffy, the Vampire Slayer.
Yeah, who is very hot, I might add.
Thank you, love.
Ow!
But, yeah, I have, like, kind of a problem. My boyfriend is leaving, like, to the military kind of thing.
How old is he? You're 16.
Yeah, he's going to be 19, or, yeah.
Unacceptable.
Is he going to boot camp?
Yeah. And while he's there, he says he, like, doesn't want to write, talk, anything. Like, after he leaves, he says he, like, wants nothing to do with me, if, like, supposedly for my own good.
Are you in love with this guy?
He's kind of right.
Well, yeah.
Well, yeah, but, like, okay, I've been with him for, like, over a year now.
Crystal?
Yeah.
I'm no genius, but you're only 16. This guy's taken off. He is 19. You have 2 more years of high school, I assume. Mm-hmm. So many guys are going to be in your school. Yeah. He's going to boot camp, and when he comes back, he will be such a different person, it'll make your head spin.
Yeah.
Oh, I know, but, like, I figure if we, like, still keep in contact while he's in boot camp, it wouldn't be that much of a shock if he comes back.
No.
Does he have to go on a tour of, you know, does he have to go away for a while, even after the basic training?
Yeah.
How long is he going to be gone for?
He'll probably, at the very most, be gone for 2 years, but he's in for, like, 5, and he's thinking,
all right,
well,
Crystal,
he's in for
5. Wait, 2 years?
By the time he comes back, you should be going to some college.
You should have
hopefully been
through 5 to 6 boyfriends
by
that time.
He is being so considerate. He really is. Yeah. As opposed to leaving you clinging together, he's being realistic. He's breaking it off.
No,
it's very hard.
He's not breaking it off, though. He's saying as soon as he leaves, he doesn't want to have anything to do with me. But while he's here, he wants to, like, do me.
Have sex,
know?
Of course.
Yeah.
But he's a guy, after all.
Yeah, he's male.
Oh, I do the same thing. Seriously.
Just because he wants to have a physical relationship while he's still in your physical presence doesn't mean he doesn't want to break it off when he's gone.
I know, but isn't that, like, jerkish?
Yes, it is.
All guys are. They want the punani.
Yeah.
Oh, I understand that, but I'm not saying that I don't want him either, you know?
Right.
Yeah, well, make a decision, though. Maybe it'd be better for you to end it up sooner. That's not a bad thing. I think he's being very considerate.
Me too.
Yeah, it's very painful, but the other choice is even worse.
Yeah, well, I don't know because, I don't know, he's just, like, really weird, and he comes up with, like, all these, like, weird, odd ideas for, like, things to be, like, things have to be his way or the highway, and it's just really bad. And
well, perfect. Now's the chance for you to get the hell out of this. When he leaves, he's breaking it off. He's doing the right thing. If you don't want to, if you're pissed that he wants to have sex with you before he's leaving, deny him. Deny him. He'll send you flowers then, you know, then maybe you give in, I guess. Mm-hmm. All right, let's try to squeeze in, Anderson, how much time, when do we got? Let's grab one more. Drew, you can pick this last one. Go ahead.
Mm-hmm. Well, I can't get it up now. I mean, I can't.
There we go. Go out on that.
Yeah, we're going out on that.
Put that on a loop, huh?
Yeah, he's already got it. He's way
there we go.
Here. All right, William.
Yes, how you doing?
All right, let's make this one kind of quick if you can. You're 19. Thanks for waiting.
Oh, no problem. I just have a quick question. For the past 3 months, I have been, I'll be dead asleep, and all of a sudden I'll wake up and I have to vomit. And it's nothing like a little, like, phlegm or anything. It's like what I ate during the day.
All right. Well, that's. Do you have any medical problems?
I was born premature, 7 weeks.
That's it.
And I have a polio on my leg, and the doctors say I might have sleep apnea because of my dad.
Are you overweight?
No.
You're fat.
And are you on any medication?
No, I'm not on any medication.
Okay. Well, you're describing reflux, which is basically the content of your stomach fluxing back up into your esophagus when you lie flat. Why at 19 the sphincter between your esophagus and your stomach wouldn't work is a mystery to me. There's a muscle there. There's like a sphincter there.
Mm-hmm.
And it needs to be evaluated. You need some testing to look at what's going on there.
Okay.
This is not normal for a 19-year-old.
All right.
Not taking Motrin or anything like that?
No.
No aspirins?
No.
All right.
Okay. Flintstone kids, William?
Get it checked out.
Oh, and
Don't take the Barney, man. That's
just,
you know.
What's that, William?
Addictive.
He had a good speech tonight at Sac State.
Oh, thanks. You were there?
Yeah, I was in the second row.
Wow.
He's the one that vomited.
Oh, yeah, that one.
Thank you, William.
No problem. Thank
okay,
you.
Bye. Bye. All right. We have to take another break. Drew is going to try to get it up on that end, and James Marsters is here, and I'm Stryker, and I got it up.
All right, guys. Here's the deal. You're looking to hook up, sick of wasting time with the wrong person?
Dateline.
One call is all you need to make. Call the Dateline. 877-889-DATE.
Call the Dateline.
Thank you.
All right, we're back. It's Loveline. Dr. Drew, who was in Sacramento, actually just took off because he's trying to catch a plane to get back to Los Angeles right now. I am Stryker, along with James Marsters, and I want to thank you so much for coming in.
Man, my pleasure, as always.
Man, with cool guests like you, it makes it so much easier on my part.
Well, we didn't have any questions about swollen testicles, so it made it a lot easier for me.
We had a couple last night.
Yeah, well, you know, it's good.
And I thought all about you. You can see James. He plays the character of Spike on Buffy the Vampire Slayer. They are on the UPN. It's Tuesdays at 8 p.m. Also, reruns are being shown on FX weekdays at 7 p.m.
Yeah, hold on to your hats, folks. It's going to get real weird.
Anything you want to tell us super quick, then I got to sign off.
No,
he has nothing to say.
God, it's hard. We're not supposed to release any secrets, but the Slayer's dead. Worms are eating her brain. And there are no cops in Sunnydale. The demons are having a heyday.
There you go. All right. I'm Stryker. You can see what I look like on MTV Monday at 5 p.m., by the way, and Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday for weeks to come. God bless America. Thanks to Ace Marcola for letting me fill in for Dr. Drew. I am Stryker saying adios.
Kiss my ass, you idiots.
Shut up, Corolla, hairy bastard.
This has been Loveline. The opinions expressed on this show are not necessarily those of the staff, management, sponsors, or this station.
The producer for Loveline is Ann Wilkins Engel. Loveline is a presentation of Westwood One Entertainment.